Penn Corridor Happenings on BCTV is supported by Weidenhammer.
Welcome again to River Place Happenings. I'm your host, Kevin Barnhart. The last time we were together, back early spring of 2009, we were River Place Happenings. Now there's a lot that has taken place since the spring of 2009. As you know, River Place Corporation went on a hiatus and reorganized itself into a different group and organization, merging with Penn Corridor Initiative. So from this point on, we're going to be calling this program Penn Corridor Happenings, based on the Penn Corridor Initiative. And my guest today is John Weidenhammer, the president, the former president of River Place Development Corporation, now the president of the Penn Corridor Initiative. Good afternoon, John.
Good afternoon, Kevin. How are you? I'm doing super. Thanks so much for having me on the program. Thank you. Thought I'd wear something bright, a little yellow. Hopefully it's not too bright for the camera.
Great. Tell us a little bit about where River Place and the corridor were about a year or so ago, and how you transition into this new organization.
Sure, I'd be happy to do that. But first of all, let me just thank you for taking the time to put this program together. On behalf of the whole River Place Development Corporation, Penn Corridor team, we really appreciate your efforts to try to get the message out to the community by virtue of this program.
You're most welcome. So great work.
We just hope we're able to continue this.
It's a fantastic initiative.
Agreed. So where we were a year ago, and I guess probably the pivotal event in December of 2008, I had one of our board, one of the River Place Development Corporation board members call me, and he said, you know, John, I'm getting ready to write my 2008 contribution to River Place, and I'm really struggling doing it because here we are in the global economic slowdown. People are losing their jobs. There are people that are hungry. There are people who can't pay their utility bills, and I'm just struggling with sending a check to River Place because maybe that money could be invested better in social services. So that was kind of a wake-up call to me. And I looked at all the money that we were spending on River Place and thought, you know, maybe there's a different or a better way to do this. So we had a, River Place had a strategy session coming up in January of 2009. I believe you might have been there at least for part of that. And we talked about this whole issue of, can River Place really go forward as a sustainable organization spending about $250,000 to $300,000 a year? And is that the right way to invest scarce funds in our community? So we prepared to address that issue. So that's kind of number one.
So we hit recessionary times back at the end of 2008, and you had to kind of refocus.
Exactly. And I'll circle back to that. At the same time, Burke's Economic Partnership had been the home for the Penn Corridor Steering Committee. So it wasn't really an organization. It was just a committee that operated under the aegis of Burke's Economic Partnership. BEP was having some those same kind of conversations. You know, can we really afford to be doing things that are not completely on task with the efforts of BEP to bring business to Berks and to foster the growth of business in Berks and create an environment where businesses can both come to Berks County and grow and stay in Berks County.
So BEP fostered or initiated the Penn Corridor Initiative. As an economic catalyst.
They did, as an economic catalyst, and they pretty much funded its development and provided the administrative support for what they called the Penn Corridor Steering Committee. They did things like run the website, they published a newsletter, they used Twitter as a way of getting messaging out regarding things that were happening along the corridor. So what we had back in the end, so just to finish that up, so the Burke's Economic Partnership Executive Committee decided that they would try to find another home for the Penn Corridor Steering Committee. So here we are at the end of 2008, beginning of 2009, and we've got two activities, if you want to call it that, River Place Development Corp, Penn Corridor Steering Committee, really looking for a different business model, if you will, for a different way to go forward. So out of that, what happened is the River Place Development Corporation met in January of 2009 and made a decision that we would move from an organization that had two full-time staff and one part-time staff person to really being an all-volunteer organization. So we made a decision at that time to wind down the scope of River Place Development Corporation and really just focus on advocacy and maybe to just become a lot smaller of an organization and maybe even take a hiatus from current activity.
Okay.
At the same time, Penn Carter Steering Committee was looking to find an association, looking for a way to continue moving forward. So, and just by way of context for your viewers, it might be important to note that River Place was an organization that got started in about 2003. Mm-hmm. The idea was, what can we do to use this magnificent resource that we have along the Schuylkill River to build something maybe like we have down at Inner Harbor in Baltimore, or maybe like we have at the Riverwalk in San Antonio. Mm-hmm. So that was kind of the vision. Really, the vision for River Place was, how can we turn what has sort of become the back door of Reading into the front door of Reading and really be a vibrant aspect of our community? And the target area of River Place was generally from Heritage Park, which is down at Canal Street,
okay,
to the Schuylkill Avenue Bridge. So that's about a little over 2 mile stretch of prime real estate on both sides of the river, and River Place was dedicated to fostering development not only on the river, but you know, maybe out a couple blocks in the various communities. At the same time, if we look at the Penn Corridor, we've traditionally defined the Penn Corridor and within the Penn Corridor Steering Committee as an area that really runs maybe from City Park along Penn Street, across the Penn Street Bridge, then up Penn Avenue in West Reading and Wyomissing, all the way to the area around where the post office, mm-hmm, and the works is in Wyomissing. So that's about a 2.5 mile, mm-hmm, stretch. So a natural phenomenon kind of was, you have the river running north-south, you had the Penn Corridor running east-west, so you have a natural intersection there at the Penn Street Bridge, and really a lot of common area and essentially a common mission for trying to develop a vibrant urban core, mm-hmm, for Berks County. So
this is a great way to combine forces and resources.
A great
you had two, and I wouldn't say competition, but you had some overlap, obviously. With River Place and with Penn Corridor, you had a lot of activity down along the river that was also connected with Penn Corridor.
Exactly,
right.
Exactly, and you're right. It wasn't competition, but you know, you had two separate organizations that really were operating on parallel tracks.
Mm-hmm.
So it just made perfect sense to bring these two organizations together. There were a few common elements in terms of the Penn Corridor Steering Committee and the River Place Development Corporation Board. But there was enough of diversity, mm-hmm, that bringing two organizations together and really creating a new board made a lot of sense. So with that essentially in mind, River Place Development Corporation, at a strategy session that we held in January of 2009, made that decision I talked about to become an all-volunteer organization, mm-hmm, and to scale back the size of our board,
okay,
to make room for bringing the Penn Corridor Steering Committee, certain members of the Penn Corridor Steering Committee group, onto the board of River Place Development Corp. So we took that action. We started meeting jointly to sort of define what the elements were and what a strategy would be for this combined group on a going forward basis. In June, Sharon Danks facilitated another strategy session, mm-hmm, of this combined group to kind of figure out what the combined River Place and Penn Corridor group would do. And we decided really to focus on three areas, primarily to work on clean and safe,
okay,
in Reading, and to support the efforts of Chuck Broad and the Downtown Improvement District, primarily to try to find funding for them to outsource their activities to SGI, which has now happened and is really going well. As I was coming in here, I saw one of the red-coated DID guys walking down in the area of
conspicuous out on the street.
They're
fabulous job.
They're conspicuous. I think the uniforms are sharp. From what I'm hearing, the merchants are responding to the services that they're providing. They have new equipment to do cleaning of sidewalks and so forth. So the Clean and Safe essentially was one area that we were gonna focus on. The other area was that we would focus on events and marketing along the corridor. The idea being that in addition to Clean and Safe, as you bring activity to the corridor, not only did the merchants benefit from that, but also the characteristics and the demographic of the neighborhoods can change. You know, the more activity there is, the more the businesses prosper, the more customers will come, and you get into this upward cycle of economic development. And the third area that we decided we would focus on is the area of arts, again, along the Penn Corridor in both sides of the river. River Place was the holder of $50,000 of funds for public art projects in the city. So our hope was that we could parlay some of those funds and others that we might be able to attract to bring public art to the corridor and along the river as well. So those three areas, Clean and Safe, marketing and events, and arts along the corridor. The other hope, obviously, is that this new organization, and you mentioned this right at the beginning, we agreed that we would call the combined organization the Penn Corridor Initiative. So River Place Development Corporation, a 501c3.
Nonprofit.
Essentially a nonprofit organization. While we may, at least temporarily, until we can change the name with the state and the federal government, we may have the legal name of River Place Development Corporation. We're going to do business, as you mentioned, as Penn Corridor Initiative. So there will be that doing business as Penn Corridor Initiative part of our mission. But again, our big picture thing is to work on advocacy for activities along the corridor and along the riverfront, and to do things like this to basically get the word out to folks through this kind of programming. We're going to continue to do the newsletters, maintain our website, use Twitter as a way to alert people to what's going on.
Has the website changed the name at all? Is it still River Place?
Well, there are two websites now. Okay. There's still the River Place Development Corporation website, which is at riverplacepa.com, I think it is. And then there's the Penn Corridor website. And the goal is that we're going to migrate the River Place content, where we have a lot of rich content. We're going to migrate the River Place content to the Penn Corridor, the current Penn Corridor website, and really have a combined website, and then we'll redirect the River Place URL just to the Penn Corridor. So people can still use riverplacepa.com, but it'll just be redirected.
You're watching Penn Corridor Happenings on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information about your community and other local stories, go to bctv.org. Penn Corridor Happenings on bctv.org is underwritten by Weidenhammer Systems Corporation. For more information on how you and your business can become a program underwriter, go to bctv.org.
So through your leadership, we brought the strength of River Place and Penn Corridor together under one umbrella.
Correct.
It took a little time for all the good, well-intended people and its tremendous group, both boards, to finally figure out what their mission and their focus was, and it's great. Now, those people who really supported River Place as a standalone group for the last couple of years, are they going to see any change? Are they going to still see the same efforts being taken on River Place? Or now is it blended in with Penn Corridor? Are they going to lose out? Or is it going to be enhanced? I think for those people that are concerned about River Place.
I don't think it's going to be enhanced. I think that would be too strong of a statement. But the plan is to continue to work on development along the riverfront. Mm-hmm. But to recognize that riverfront development is probably a longer term project, with the exception of a few things that we're working on now and a few things that we can likely finish in the short term. The name is changing to Penn Carter Initiative, and I think that the emphasis is going to change a little bit. Okay. To probably add a little bit more priority to the corridor, simply because in the estimate of a lot of people, you know, not just me, and by the way, you mentioned under my leadership, but this whole thing has been a great team effort, and you've been part of that team.
It was
team.
Like herding cats there for a period of time. It did a tremendous job.
It was. Well, thank you, but it's been a great team effort, and we have a wonderful board, and I think it's because of the folks that have been attracted to this effort that we're gonna be successful. But so work along the river continues. So okay. and we're not gonna diminish that. But the emphasis in the short term here is gonna be along the corridor where we think there's a greater likelihood of getting things done, and to a degree
on a shorter time frame than the river.
And in a shorter time frame. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't have to tell you about the economic struggles that mm-hmm. exist, not just
exactly.
generally in the private sector of the economy, but also in the public sector. I mean, the county struggles from time to time financially with some of the projects mm-hmm. they'd like to do. Certainly, we have a city in Act 47 that's struggling right. a little bit. You have historic or legacy involvement with West Reading. Why missing? The global economic slowdown has impacted municipal and county governments' ability to make infrastructure in investments. So
we all have to get more creative.
So exactly, mm-hmm. we have to get more creative. We maybe have to change the timeline for getting things done. But at the end of the day, the whole community really, really benefits from having a vibrant urban core in the center of Berks, right. Berks County. You know, there are some folks that think, well, gee, you know, the kind of the hole in the donut theory, you know, if we, you know, we don't worry about investment in the core of Berks County, you know, everybody can live happily ever after out mm-hmm. in the suburbs. And that just doesn't seem like a workable model to me. I mean, we've got to make the whole community work. You know, we're not going to pick up the courthouse and move it all of a sudden no. to, you know, Burnville or something like that. So, you know, the seat of the county's gonna be here. We have a significant portion of our population that lives, you know, close in to the core of the city. So we really need to make it work. And I'd say at the end of the day that a big part of what we're trying to accomplish through the Penn Carter Initiative is revitalization mm-hmm. of the core. It's about economic development. It's about creating jobs. It's about just getting things going and having the core of Reading be a destination that people want to go to, you know, rather than going someplace else, you know, to King of Prussia or Baltimore Inner Harbor. You know, let's have the core of our community be a destination that people seek out for, you know, restaurants and entertainment. I think we've had a great example of what can happen, you know, right outside of your window here at the Sovereign Center. Mm-hmm. You know, there were justifiably a lot of skeptics in our community mm-hmm. about why do we need a convention entertainment venue. I think there were folks that were even concerned about the investment that was made at the Sovereign Performing Arts Center. And over time, I think both of those venues have proven to be...
It's proven itself since 2001, hasn't it? I guess it's on year 9.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
And it just shows what can happen. And I mean, despite the fact that, you know, we have an economic slowdown, the Sovereign Center continues to work and book, you know, great acts. I think also, you know, an example, and I'll say that I was one of the doubters about both of these projects. But when I go to the Goggle Works at night and see all the parents that are there with kids coming in for dance lessons and music lessons and so forth, you know, I must say I was skeptical about mm-hmm. whether that would happen. You know, while the Goggle Works, I think, struggles a little bit financially, its programming is first rate and is really doing a terrific job and shows the possibilities. Likewise, when Al Bosco talked about, building the IMAX theater mm-hmm. right across from the Goggle Works,
skeptical.
I thought, big time skeptical. Mm-hmm. I thought, you know, the last thing this community needs is another movie theater, and in this location, people are going to have to drive by another movie theater coming from Mount Penn or Wyomissing or out of Muhlenberg Township to get to this one. Yet, you know, I take my grandsons to that mm-hmm. theater all the time.
And they frequent it quite a bit.
And it's packed. Yeah. It's unbelievable. Mm-hmm. In fact, we went there to see the Squeakquel, the Alvin movie, mm-hmm. and it just showed up on a Sunday afternoon, and it was sold out. I couldn't believe it. We had to wait 45 minutes to get the next feature. So, you know, it to me, that shows what the possibilities are and what can happen. And sometimes, you know, despite skepticism on the part of the community, if we get behind a project, if you know, visionary people, you know, step up and make an investment and you know, commit their hard-won resources to a project, you know, things can emerge that Great. Really exceed expectations. And what we're hoping to do through the Penn Corridor Initiative is keep a focus on the core of the city to create an environment where the public sector and the private sector can come together to invest. Certainly, there's not enough money available in the public sector to do all the infrastructure mm-hmm. and all the development themselves. So we're going to have to create an environment where entrepreneurs will come, put their hard-won capital at risk to try to build businesses and to help foster growth in our community. So that's what we're trying to do.
John, for the viewers, let's redefine the area, the Penn Corridor. Where does it run? What municipalities? What's the length of it? Does it just, is it strictly Penn Avenue and Penn Street?
No. Well, it's if we look at it at its extremes, it runs it's from City Park okay. all the way to the works in Wyomissing, so along Penn Street and Penn Avenue on the western side of the river. So it touches Reading, it touches West Reading, it touches Wyomissing. And it's not just Penn Street and Penn Avenue.
Okay.
It spills out at least several blocks, 2-3 blocks on either side. So that's kind of the target area. And that encompasses a significant part of the riverfront, particularly in the core, around where RAC is and where the Goggle Works and where the IMAX Theater is. So, I mean, that's essentially its fullest extent. But trying to develop the whole thing all at once is going to be like trying to boil the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
What we're going to have to do is focus on certain centers in an effort to really get them developing and vibrant, and then maybe expand out into the neighborhood. So, you know, maybe there are 5 or 6 power centers along the corridor.
Okay.
The Sovereign Center mm-hmm. Being one, Fifth and Penn being another. Maybe the area at, you know, sort of the 200 and 300 block of Penn Street and RAC and, okay. and the Goggle Works area and the movie theater. Another area. Then if we look across the Penn Street Bridge, you know, there's often called the Chocolate Factory District, mm-hmm. you know, which is right there around where Palmer's.
That was the Sasaki plan, where there were several, like 5 or 6 neighborhoods along the corridor.
Exactly. So you have the Chocolate Factory, you have the area around where
Shopping District.
The Shopping mm-hmm. District. And then, of course, you go further out into the area, what they call now Wyomissing Square, mm-hmm. which is really VF. It's the new Viva and the works. So one of the activities that Penn Corridor is trying to do is to bring signage to each of those mm-hmm. areas. So we begin to brand these six, seven, however many there are, districts with...
And connect them.
To brand them and to begin right. to connect them so that... You get activity in each one of those areas on a standalone basis, and then it basically bleeds together until you have a vibrant corridor that spans the whole area from City Park all the way west to
And I know earlier you mentioned partners like the Downtown Improvement District, Berks Economic Partnership. Who else is helping in a partnership and collaborating with the Penn Corridor Initiative?
Well,
you don't want to slight anybody.
No. You're right. We've had a wonderful relationship with all of the economic development or organizations in the community. Certainly, your folks at the county mm-hmm. have done great work. The Berks Economic Partnership we already mentioned. Greater Berks Development Corporation has been involved. The Chamber of Commerce, I think, has been effective. The Visitors Bureau has been active in helping to promote the
committees.
The Carter, and there are, each of those organizations has committees that have contributed to this. The Greater Young Professionals Organization has been very, very active. There's a West Reading Merchants organization that has representation on our board.
And they all have a seat at the table.
They all have a seat at the table. Mm-hmm. And we're hoping that they can all engage in some of the activities that we're trying to do as well. So really, I think great things come from collaboration. This really is a collaborative effort. Certainly, the county commissioners, and not just yourself, have been very active in sort of shepherding this process along. I mean, your hand and Christian Leinbach and Mark Scott also have been active at trying to help push this thing along. I mean, clearly you're championing this with this news program, but it's been a great team effort, and I think that's going to spell the difference between success and failure for the Penn Carter Initiative. If we come together as a community and collaborate well for the future, this thing is
limitless possibilities.
It really is limitless possibilities.
Sure is.
And I was just down in South Carolina in Greenville. And it's amazing to see what they've done there. What we sometimes forget, though, when we visit places like Greenville, is that this happened over 40 years. So this is a long journey. Where I remember,
we want instant gratification, right?
We do. Well, that's kind of the American way. We want to take a pill and have everything go away, and it's difficult to do. But I often think when I go to Inner Harbor, when I worked in the public accounting business for Ernst & Ernst, we had a client that was down there. This is before anything happened. And it was a dangerous place at night. I remember going to work for a customer of ours in their data center, and there were like three or four levels of security you had to go through just to get into the building. Now you have a complete transformation of that area. What we're trying to do is to have a complete transformation in a very positive way of the core of Reading. And you're part of that, and we have a great team working on it as well.
So, John, let our viewers know what they can expect in the early part of 2010. We'll be back with Penn Carter happenings on an every other month basis, but let them know what's going to take place in the spring if you can.
Well, there's so much happening. Probably this may have happened by the time this airs, but this coming Thursday on February 11th, there's a wine walk in along the corridor.
Part of First Thursday.
Part of the First Thursday events that we've been having. So that kind of happens every Thursday, every month. The Greater Reading Young Professionals Organization is having their Gigi event at the Gateway Building on the fourth floor there on March 6th. So we encourage everybody to come out from that. Come out for that. So lots happening. Earth Day, don't miss Earth Day.
We have
so much
to get into. A half an hour, we just completely ran out of time. Once again, I'm your host, Kevin Barnhart, for Penn Carter Happenings, formerly River Place Happenings, and the president of the Penn Carter Initiative is John Weidenhammer. I want to thank him so much for his time this afternoon, and we look forward to seeing you in the near future to really start to get people more excited and get your arms around this Penn Carter Initiative. It's a great experience, and this county can move mountains if we put enough people behind it and get it moving along. Thank you, and have a great day.
Penn Carter Happenings on BCTV is supported by Weidenhammer.